next item is public comment. Is there any comments from the public for items that are not currently on the agenda? Yes, sir.
How are we doing on our one house roads?
I believe the information was compiled, but in the transition of town managers, I think it's been kind of on delay since last fall.
So it's still ongoing, or is that?
Yeah, it hasn't been dismissed, but it hasn't advanced either.
I just want to keep going, Jack.
I have a comment, but a question. Could you talk at all about the nature of the executive session plan, right?
I believe 313 AB is real estate.
No, it's a labor relation. Yeah.
So I'm mistaken. Yes. I'm sorry, could you please state your name for?
Sure, I'm Brooke Dingledean. It's not on your agenda, but just to put on your radar, there is a petition that's circulating in town where signatures are being obtained for folks who are interested in not having a massive solar array in Randolph Center. There are a number of concerns that have been articulated by folks in the community, and they've been reduced to a petition. I understand presently there are 172 verified signatures of registered voters who have signed the petition. The petition, they will continue to get more signatures so that when NextEra comes to the select board to talk about their proposal, or once they put their petition in, there are many people that would like the select board and the planning commission to take a position opposed to the solar array for a laundry list of reasons that are articulated in the petition. So I just thought it would be helpful for the select board to be aware of this. The planning commission is aware as well. I have copies just with no signatures on them, but copies of the petition, and also some overlays on Google Earth of the actual solar array that represent and give an overall view of the incredibly large size that will be utilized by the 96,000 solar panels that will be erected on 110 acres. So it's just information we thought would be helpful if the select board were aware of it. And so I'll just leave you with copies.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you.
Thank you. Do you guys have any questions or comments on that?
Not right now.
Okay. Thank you for providing us. Any other public comment? Hearing none, we'll move on to the approval of the agenda.
If I may, I would like to ask the board to consider making two changes to the agenda, both under other businesses, since we can't really amend the agenda today. One being adding a dry hydrant grant request that was submitted by the Randolph Village Fire Department and their work with the Brunswick School. And the other is we were approached by RECDC, and they would like to work with the town to define their working relationship with the town going forward. So if we could add that to the agenda, then the board could have more of that and then share with RECDC.
Any objections to
that,
Ian?
No,
I'm fine with that.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to approve the modified agenda.
I make a motion.
Second.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? So carried. Consent calendar.
The minutes are in everyone's packet, and also the warrants were previously shared with the board via email, and they're also here. Would like to take a second look at them.
I'm going to make a motion to approve the consent calendar.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? So carried. New business, assembly permit application for the 4th of July fireworks.
The Randolph Village Fire Department submitted an assembly permit for their annual fireworks display, 4th of July. The application is in the packets. The Village Fire Department has submitted their layout. They have submitted insurance requirements and then also documentation with regard to their contract with North Star Fireworks.
Any questions regarding this permit application?
It's fine to me.
It's like the same setup we do every year.
Same last year.
Mm-hmm.
Same every year.
Your turn.
It'll be new again. It'll be great.
I move to approve the festival permit application for the fireworks display.
Second it.
All right. Motion made and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstaining? So carried. Festival permit application.
The next item is not fully complete. Mr. Shane Niles has applied for a permit to hold his third annual Brewfest. He has not fully completed the application because he was out of town. He and I have been working together on a number of different projects, and this one included. I asked that he consider postponing it, but the challenge that he's now facing is that he would like to approve, or he would like to seek the approval of the board so that he can then move with other state permitting that he has to comply with. He understands that the application isn't complete as is, but requests that the board conditionally approve his request for the third annual Brewfest, with the condition being that he complete the application for assembly and then also work through the process with me. If the board approves, then if the board conditionally approves, then I will work with him. And if for some reason he doesn't comply with the requirements, the select board can then not award him.
They give you a date as to when he thought it would be?
Within a week, he and I could probably pull everything together.
Okay, so short term?
Short term. Yeah.
Is there any changes from last year?
No, the layout remains the same. There are some issues with the map that was submitted. And this is not the current map. This map includes a bonfire. There is actually no planned bonfire, and that created a discussion between the Randolph Village Fire Chief and I, and we clarified that with Shane. So he's aware that the map that was submitted, not by him, by someone else that was working with him, is not complete, but he would like a little bit of help in getting this approved in advance.
So the bonfire is in or out?
Out. No bonfire.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
The fire's out.
Okay.
I'm fine with it. I'll make a motion to approve the permit condition upon him working with Adelfo to finalize the application.
Okay. I'll second it. I'll take one for you.
All right.
Okay. No other discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? So carried. Liquor license for Cafe Salute.
Yes,
I think
this
I said
is,
that right.
Yeah, right. It is a new eatery that is opening in town. It is the extension of the, well, not really an extension, but connected with the current owners of Black Bear Tavern. They would like to request that the town approve a liquor license so that they can commence conducting business at the old 3B location.
Okay, motion is made and seconded. No other discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Passes 3-0. Budget committee.
This is an ongoing issue with the budget committee. I have attempted to try to get the committee to comply with their mandate, which was issued by the voters in 1997 select town meeting. And that requires the budget committee to meet monthly to review town budget material and also to brief the select board at least once per quarter on what they are seeing with the budget materials. There was an initial interest in participating and fulfilling that part, at the very least the quarterly briefings with the select board. Since then, members of the board, at least the chair, has refused, has actively refused to do that. And so I am still working with them, going back and forth on reminding them of their voter set mandate to report to the board to review the monthly expenditures of the town. And if they are not choosing to do their entire job, then they are in violation of what the voter asked them to do. So the response I received was that the chair is out of town until October and will then only consider my request. Of your terms. So that's where we are with the budget committee. I did inform them that they were on the agenda the last two meetings, and at both times that they are not in compliance because we are now at the end of the first quarter of the year and they have not complied with coming to talk about it.
They have another person, because when I served on the budget committee, we met every month, and we provided that information.
I've reminded the chair that there are three members and that any one of the three could come and commence the relationship with the board, ask what the board is looking for from the committee on the quarterly, at the very least the quarterly briefings. And the chair has said that they are elected officials and are not required to do that part of the job. So.
Are they meeting monthly or not?
No.
They're not meeting monthly.
They're not meeting monthly anymore?
So this month, they were supposed to meet Tuesday of this week. They decided that there was no changes, so they weren't going to meet this month.
Interesting.
They're wording in the email.
Okay.
Well. I think we need to, obviously this is up to them, but I think we need to encourage them to set a meeting date and keep it. I believe Mike DiCabellis indicated that he couldn't get the financials done for the previous month until after the second week of the following month. And they are meeting the second Tuesday of the month, and that ends up being before Mike can get them done sometimes.
Yeah.
And so I think we need to encourage them to meet on a certain date, maybe closer to the end of the month, so the information they provide us is a little more current. But I think that needs to happen on a regular basis. If they do not get 100% participation in person at even 2/3 of the meetings,
yeah,
that I know of, and being the board liaison, when they switch the meetings, it makes it difficult for me to attend. So my participation the last couple of months has been absent. Mm-hmm. So, but I think we need to reach out to them again and remind them.
Okay.
Who are the board members?
Mike Penrod, Rick Hauser, and CJ Stump.
Mm-hmm. I'll continue to work with them and I'll remind them, and I'll suggest that they consider a different meeting time. I have spent time figuring out exactly when the committee was created to see if it was created through a non-Australian ballot vote or not. If it was just created through other business at town meeting, then the select board can remove members and appoint them. But this committee was created through a vote, a warrant vote, so we would not be able to take that action unless we were changing the members. It's a little more of a complicated process because of the way the committee was created.
I don't believe at that time we were doing a show about it yet, were we?
For budget committee?
For anything.
I was nominated from the floor.
Yeah. Well, it's still nominated from the floor now, but the creation of the committee.
Yeah. I don't know about that part.
I believe. Created in 1932 through a warrant meeting, and then in 1997 it was amended to the current format, which is... The old format had the clerk as a member, had the select board member as an official voting member, and it included two or three other members. In 1997, it was amended to just the three members and one select board member as a non-voting ex officio member.
Mm. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, water and wastewater allocation requests.
We Town staff, the Water and Wastewater Committee recently met to consider several, or two requests for additional water and wastewater allocation. The first being from the Café Sandu business owner that is renting at the previous location for Reading Café, 22 Pleasant Street. And the second request is coming from Keegan and Lindsay Hopp, and they are at 6 Park Street, and they are going to be constructing a family gym with accompanying apartments on site. The committee recommends that the board approve both the wastewater and water allocation.
Okay, any questions?
No, I have some questions. So this is a little pet peeve of mine for years. And I really think that this is a deterrent to businesses that come to the community, because I have a suspicion, and that feels to me like it's a little bit discriminatory about how it's handled, because certain businesses get charged a lot for allocation and certain businesses don't. Their economic viability, I think, is important to the community regardless of what they do. And so I've been thinking for years that we should waive these fees, and I realize that's probably not possible without having some long in-depth conversations with the Water and Sewer Advisory Board. But I do think that we could, and I think I've got my information correctly, that we could actually schedule these payments to be more cash flow positive instead of one lump sum to these businesses. So I'm suggesting that maybe we talk about that a little bit. So,
okay.
Any thoughts?
I'm not exactly familiar with how the rates are set up or the fees, but I wouldn't be opposed to a more in-depth conversation.
Yeah, I'm happy to talk about it. I'm not sure that it's really on the agenda, though.
I understand it's not on the agenda, but I do believe we have the authority to structure those payments so that they would come in such a way that are cash flow positive. We can't waive them. We can't do anything about that right now, but I do think we could do that.
So
my understanding is we've done this for other businesses.
So you're thinking we can just make a one time for these properties?
No, I think going forward we should try to encourage business development here, and
right.
I think this is one way.
I think that's a conversation that should be its own thing, not
okay.
just tied to these particular allocations. Because there might be other people who have views about how we do things,
mm-hmm.
As a system.
And you're referring to just new allocations or increase in allocations, not...
I think increases and new allocations. You can't do anything about what's already passed. But I know that the town of Hartford, last year waived all allocation fees because they looked at this as a deterrent to economic development. And I've thought that for years. And I think of some examples over the years where, businesses that were coming to the community didn't realize they had to pay them, and all of a sudden they got whacked with a $15,000 allocation fee. And so I think that gives us a negative, other communities are changing the way they do this. And my understanding is that that money just flows into the general fund. It doesn't get set aside for any form of depreciation against the system. So, which is what I was told years ago it was supposed to happen, is that money was supposed to be set aside at the time we came to do infrastructure improvements, but that's not the case, because there's no line item for that in the budget anywhere as I've seen. So, just something to throw out there.
So it sounds like it should be reviewed holistically.
Mm-hmm. Because I think that, that amount of money, in some cases, is significant to some people's startup costs. And so I think that, it's not sending a business-friendly message. So in this case, we have the authority to, we could talk about scheduling they'd pay the total payment, but we could give them something that might match cash flow situation better.
Does that sound right to you at all?
It is possible. We've had conversations with staff on how to make the town more business friendly, and it includes making changes to the water and wastewater impact fees. We found that a lot of new businesses that are coming up have expressed concern over having to pay, in some cases, depending on the business, a lot of money up front when it's at the most critical time for business to have cash flow. There are strategies that we've talked about internally with staff, and then also in previous select board meetings, it was talked about making impact fees either go away, or a structure where we could have an initial upfront payment of, you know, 10%, 15%, 20%, just to make sure that businesses are actually very serious about opening up. And then the remainder of the balance could be then broken down of the impact fee, not of the user fee, but the impact fee of, you know, 15% for the next 6 quarters, or whatever the percentage is to recoup that cost over the next 2 or 3 quarters of payments. So essentially, the businesses would be allowed to establish themselves, start making money, become revenue positive, and then we could then start charging for the impact fee in the built-in way, as opposed to just upfront big cash payment.
I guess my question was, does the SEC board have the authority to change how the impact fees are paid right now for these two applications?
The board does have the authority to make a structured payment. It'd be challenging to not have a warned item if we're not going to have any kind of impact fee for business.
But Perry's not suggesting that. He's just suggesting that we spread
just
some of these
spread
payments
the payments out over maybe 6 quarters or something.
Right. The board would have the authority, and the board also has the option to pass something conditionally upon us checking with our attorney to make sure that it's possible. And if our attorney comes back and says, yes, it's possible, then the motion can go into effect. And if our attorney says, well, you have to do certain steps, then the motion can then not go into effect until the next meeting. But at the very least, if the board is interested, we can make that motion, and then I can check it down with the attorney.
And the other option was, if you made the motion to do that, and you find out from the attorney that it can't be done, then they just can pay the full fee.
Yeah. I can say that one of the businesses that's opening up has also approached me about a potential tax stabilization agreement. They are interested in pursuing that. They understand that what they are hoping to do is going to be a positive thing for the town. They understand the recreation and gym activities are lacking. And they are hoping to take as much advantage of the benefits that are out there, including downtown designation, which is one of the strategies that the town has in place to make it easier for businesses to open up a new construction. So one of the businesses especially is very interested in having more cash flow up front so that they can then operate.
Okay.
So do you want to, would you consider approving, conditionally approving, giving them the option to spread it over 1 year, 4 quarters?
4 quarters or 6, I was just doing the calculations. If you did 50% down, or if you did 20% down, and you divided that out, so you divide the remaining 80 over the next 5 quarters, or 4 quarters, then it would be about, you know, you'd be into it for 1.25 years, you'd have the full fee. So if we said, you know, 20% quarterly, or do you want to be a little more front-loaded? I wouldn't think it matters whether it's a little bit more front-loaded or not front-loaded.
I don't think
so
it matters that much, just 20% per quarter.
I think 20% per quarter for the first five, for the first quarters.
The option too, in case they would rather just pay it all at once.
And they could. I mean, it's I mean, if they decided to take that option, but
each situation is different. So
yeah.
Okay. So. I'll make a motion that we approve both of these allocations, including the potential option to pay the impact fee over 5 quarters in equal installments. If after checking with the attorney that we actually have the authority to change the structure of the impact fees.
Okay. I'll second that.
Okay, motion is made and seconded. Is there any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? So carried. Land use regs amendments.
Over the course of the last several months, we found that there was one business that is very interested in moving into the area that's just further down over by the bowling alley on Prince Street. The building that is owned by Mr. Bell Thompson, he wanted to put in a building or a business in there. We found that the regulations, because it was outside, it was in the from the Foundry Park area, which is currently zoned Gateway Commercial Retail, is of insufficient square footage that would allow the type of business that wanted to open in there. So Mr. Del Thompson said, you know, we need some help. I have a business that wants to come in. The zoning isn't allowing this to happen. Let's change the zoning. And so he's been working with our town engineer and zoning administrator to make sure that he can change the zoning regulations so we can allow a business to move into that area without violating the square footage requirements. If the board would approve of setting a hearing date, then we could then set the hearing date and see if any of the members of the community oppose the changing of the regulations for the zoning. If the board would approve, we would have a minimum of 15-day waiting period and a maximum of 120 days. It's just a matter of thinking if it's a good idea, and if it is, then just picking a date on the calendar.
Planning Commission voted unanimously to make the change. It was Marty's suggestion, because we originally were looking at changing the density in that district, but instead, it, because it bordered the central business district, it made more sense to incorporate that into that district, which lowered the minimum space size from 4,000 square feet down to 1,000 square feet. So we had a public hearing last week on it, and you know, there was no opposition to it.
Okay. What's your preference for when to hold the public hearing?
Next meeting?
That would be 35 days away, I
think. Is that right? Yeah, that works.
Yeah, I'm okay with that. Yeah. Does that satisfy the sooner rather than later comment that's on there?
I think it
would certainly.
I think it does.
Yeah, it will satisfy.
Sorry, what was that
date? The next select board meeting.
June 14th.
June 14th.
Okay, and I'll make a motion to warn that in the next select board meeting.
And we'll put it at 5:30 and just move the regular board meeting back.
Okay, that'll work.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
Put it at 5:30 and then hold the regular board meeting right afterwards. Okay.
Sounds good, right?
Sarah, do we need to have a motion for that one?
We should have a motion.
Okay. Okay. Well, I made the motion to have a hearing prior to the next select board meeting to address the change in land use regulations for the Foundry Park Prince Street area.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Is there any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? So carried. 300. Police Department, district review.
We, over the last few, really over the last month, had a considerable number of our police force announce that they are leaving the force. It started with Chief Brunel, whose separation date is May 24th. We recently learned that Sergeant Stolnicker, separation date is July 5th. And we had also had a planned retirement of Sergeant Dave Layton. His last day on the force is expected to be June 30th. So hopefully about a 60% reduction in our force is expected by July 5. So it's one of the reasons why we brought this to the board, because we would like to discuss options on how to proceed, given that the immediate need is we will have two patrol officers without any of their immediate supervisors, with both sergeants that are leaving and then also the chief of police. And then also the option of if the board wanted to discuss other options that may exist, being making the police force or not making the police force, what our options are out there. So two things we're hoping that be considered by the board today. The first is to take into consideration the 60% reduction in force by July 5, and a potential agreement with the Orange County Sheriff's Department to provide, at very least, supervisory responsibilities or supervisory duties at a cost that Orange County has already established on an hourly rate. And the other is if the board so chose to potentially establish a committee that would review some of the options that exist for the village and the police district.
Thoughts or questions?
Well, I definitely think you need a committee to research and talk about that subject. In the interim, we need some sort of strategy. Shut that off. Anyway, so I think you're going to need to do something here. So the Sheriff's Department has offered, clarify what that was about.
Yes, we have received an amount from the Sheriff's Department that offered to, at our request, we were looking to see what our options are because we were no longer going to have any of our commanding officers with the force. And one of the options was to have a senior officer with the Orange County Sheriff's Department to provide supervisory duties, keep our officers on patrol, maintain the department as best we can, while still contracting out, at the very least, the supervisory duties to a senior officer in the Orange County Sheriff's Department. That agreement would really depend on what the town's needs are. We could speak with the officers and see what it is that their day-to-day operations are, what they feel would be needed from an officer or from a sheriff's deputy who'd be brought in to supervise them, bring them into the discussion to see exactly what it is that they would need going forward, since there were only two patrol officers on the force. And then at that point, we can then go back to the Sheriff's Department and say, this is what we need. It could be 1 hour a week, it could be 20 hours a week, and then tell them exactly what it is that our needs are and see if they would then fulfill those needs. That is the option currently with the Orange County Sheriff's Department to provide some kind of supervision of our department in the short term interim.
Just a little time. Yeah. Any other questions or comments from the board?
So are we currently looking for officers to fill these roles?
We are not, no. The challenge is that we were considering hiring one patrol officer because we were short one officer at the moment. And we were considering filling that position, knowing full well that we were also going to lose a sergeant to retirement. The reason why we had an open position is because the district itself is currently at a $79,000 deficit and is at a disadvantage. And there are other financial pressures on the district that kept us from being at a full force. When the issue arose of the chief leaving, the hiring of a new officer really became a secondary priority because the priority then was we're losing our chief. Shortly thereafter, we then learned that we had a second or a third really senior officer that was leaving the force, taking a separate position down in Royalton. So then the priority became hiring at the very least, or looking for options to have some kind of a senior officer to make sure that our department is meeting the administrative paperwork, has someone that could liaison with town hall, with me, so that we can work together and maintain some form of continuity with the service that we're providing. Understanding that we're going to be at a reduced force. At that point, you know, we thought, well, we'll bring it to the board. The board can decide what it would like to do. It would like to form a committee to discuss whether or not to keep the department. If it does keep the department, at what staffing levels? At that point, what is the return for the investment that the police district is making to the police department? Or any other options, any combination of options, really.
So what you're saying here is that because of this sort of confluence of transitions, that you want to take advantage of this basically as a time to say, okay, you know, all this stuff happening right now, we have an opportunity to change structure.
Yes.
And now, if we're going to be thinking about that, now's the time to do it.
That's right.
So rather than move ahead with hiring, just to keep going the way we've been going, take a step back and say, is this direction that we've been going in where we really want to continue, or should we take this opportunity to perhaps see what people really want?
That's right. It was I don't want to influence the board in any one particular way, but there was a model recently implemented in Waterbury, and their model was to create a committee to that was comprised of not just staff but also members of the community. And the model itself included a variety of different methods of communicating with the residents, public hearings, public comments, and it became a really fully engaged community app. So this way, it wasn't just the select board in Waterbury that was making the decision, it was making the decision that the community wanted to implement. So because of this perfect storm scenario that is happening here, it seemed like if the board wanted to, it would be a good opportunity to have that discussion. But the more immediate need is, we do have our two officers, and we want to make sure that they're supported as best as the town can support them by providing them with someone to issue some kind of support and leadership.
Do we need more than two officers here too? I mean, is that something the Sheriff's Department is willing to supplement too?
We can, but through my conversations with the state police, we could operate with a reduced force. We have two full-time officers, and we also have two part-time officers. We could rely on some of our part-time officers to take shifts as best as they can and fill in where they can. And any shift that is not taken or is not filled, then the state police has agreed that they would then cover.
And back us up.
They would back us up, but it would really depend on where they are at the moment. It could take 10 minutes for them to get here. It could take longer than that. So. But it would also be very challenging to staff up right away, because we wouldn't have the opportunity to vet the officers, background checks, and everything else. And it would almost be a very rushed decision to just bring the officers onto the force. The rate that was proposed by our sheriff in Orange County is roughly about $53 per hour. And if we annualize it, that rate of 20 hours a week would be roughly about $55,000 a year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't have to be the 20 hours. I mean, it could be less than that, depending on what the town needs. So if the board thought this would be a good idea, it could authorize me to mediate or facilitate a conversation between the sheriff and the board and find an amount and a number of hours that would be meaningful for them.
Okay. Any other questions or comments before I open it up?
No.
Mr. Harvey?
I think it is an opportunity for the town and the village, well, actually the town and the police district, we're going to make sure that we keep those separate in the way they vote legally, to restructure. And as a lot of you have been around here long enough, no, we didn't always have a department this big. Secondly, I think we actually had a really good opportunity because one of our police officers was the lieutenant and the operations manager for the Orange County Sheriff for 5 years and took care of all the town contracts and all the administrative. He ran all the day-to-day, and the sheriff was doing the political stuff. And he's on our force already, and now he has 4+ years more experience because we've had him here. So I think we can look internally for that kind of work, because there's actually nobody over there now that has the experience that our own officer has in running a department that size. So, and I think you're right, Carrie, committee is vital.
Exactly.
But it has to be police district, it's not.
Right, exactly. Well.
Yeah, it has to be people in the police district.
Well, there's two sides to that, because there's been numerous conversations here about townwide coverage. So maybe this, my thought is, okay, the immediate need is you got to deal with the police district, but then maybe there's a dialogue that can
right.
happen with members from outside of the police district that provide, I think a lot of people don't feel the state police gives them adequate coverage outside of the district.
Right.
So, I don't know. There's an opportunity, who knows? That's why the committee needs to talk about it.
Yeah, the Articles of Merger state that the town has to vote to ask the police district to expand the police district to the town.
Right.
And then the police district has to vote to accept the town's request to expand it.
Right.
It's backwards compared to what you think. It was just saying, let's expand it.
Yeah, no, it's got to go, I know.
Yeah, it's an odd...
It's all part of the merger package, years ago.
Yep.
We don't want to...
Right, but if you're expanding to the entire town, you may not exactly be asking permission. You may be dissolving the police district altogether and then making it a town.
But the articles of merger don't allow that, I don't believe.
Well, that would be good.
Yeah, that would be a question.
That would be a good question to bring up.
Yeah, that'd be a good question.
If you disbanded the force and then it became a townwide force or a townwide arrangement with state police or the county sheriff or whatever.
Well, this sounds like really good conversation for a committee to be having.
Doesn't it? Yeah. Absolutely.
So, should we have two motions, one for the agreement with the sheriff and one for a committee? That sound right?
Be a good idea.
Yeah.
So
So, before you do that, so do we need to talk more about the agreement and get more information? In light of the information provided, should we look into it and maybe have a special select board meeting in a couple of weeks once we get a little more info?
Absolutely.
I think that would be appropriate.
Yeah.
And then
we can figure out which.
We can evaluate it and make sure it's the right decision for us. At the very least, it may be not supervision, but additional help. Or supervision and help, but maybe look into it a little deeper.
Absolutely.
Is that okay? Before you make your motion.
No, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
I could mention that I've spoken with the chief and he feels that anyone who's brought in, whether it be support group, the sheriff's deputies are patrolling, or sheriff's deputy as coming in as supervisor in the department, wouldn't need very much layover time between his departure or just following his departure for them to be caught up with the operations of the town. So there's certainly time between now and a special meeting to make a decision.
I think it's a good idea.
For your motion, is there any other public comment? Hold on, you talk, I gotta let everybody else go.
Yeah. I agree, I think having a meeting...
Can you state your name?
William Puglisi.
Thank you.
I think having a meeting in a couple of weeks to develop a committee and to answer some of the acute question, the upfront question that you need to get would be a very good idea. So I think that's what you need to do.
Thank you.
What I had was not related. So if I could, I didn't realize there was any more public comment. May I just ask one thing? Because I know I came in a little late and I'm...
Well, if it's not about the police district, let us finish this conversation.
Okay.
I'll give you a minute after conversation to
that's
provide
all I
public
ask
comment. Okay. Back to you, Tom.
I was just going to say that whatever gets set up with that committee, there should be an understanding that it gets data-driven, that the data be made available from the call reports over the last 5 or even 10 years to analyze that data and start deciding really how we're using our resources. Because that hasn't been done except on the police commission, we did it on a minor way a couple of years ago and had some good results with it, but then things kind of fell apart with the commission.
Okay.
Bill Morgan. So Perry had mentioned this committee is going to be townwide or is it just going to be village?
We'll get to that one in just a second, I think.
Okay.
Do you have Trini's comments?
I do.
So, because I think the committee would have to evaluate all the options. I don't think we can restrict it to just the police district. I think people outside the district, because it could potentially affect them,
mm-hmm.
should have some say. And I think Trini provided some comments as far as a makeup, and see if you guys agree.
The suggestion is a committee that's comprised from members from all parts of town, in and out of the police district, select board, one from within the police district and one from outside of the police district, also the town manager. So it would be a combination of residents from within the district, outside the district, select board members from within the district, outside the district, and then the town manager.
Seems pretty reasonable.
So based on those categories, what are we talking for numbers?
If we did two per category, two, four, six, seven. Two from within the district, two outside of the district. That's four, two select board members, five, six, and the town manager, seven.
Does that work?
Sounds good to me.
Sounds pretty simple.
Okay, so should we make a motion that we authorize Adolfo to put together a list of candidates at this board at our, if we meet on the other thing in a couple weeks, to either interview or approve?
We'll start the process, yeah, absolutely.
Does that work for you, Adolfo?
Yes, you may, absolutely. The next meeting or not the special meeting?
If it's possible, if you can get a list of candidates by then, we can start the preparation with the committee, either schedule interviews or select if there isn't more than one in each category.
Sure.
Okay, so I'll entertain a motion for that. Word it how you want.
Hey, Larry, go for it.
So, I just want to make sure I'm clear before I make a motion. We want to establish this committee.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't we just do that first? Why don't we move to, we're actually not establishing the committee. Wouldn't we? Because on the next meeting, we would be trying to fill positions in that committee. Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll make a motion to establish a police district, a police, what do you call it? Police department committee?
Research.
I think it would be an ad hoc evaluation committee. I don't know.
Ad hoc police evaluation committee?
Sure.
Okay.
Based on Trey's recommendations.
Okay. And we have to have a date for this right now?
I think we just authorize him to get the candidates and to be discussed at a future meeting, I guess. I don't think we have to set a date yet.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. And authorize you to find candidates and set a date for a meeting?
Yes.
Okay, seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Passes 3-0. East Randolph Community Hall update.
Well, before.
Did you need?
It was the portion related to Orange County Sheriff's.
You need a motion for that?
May need a motion for that. I could just compile the data and then bring it back.
Yeah,
okay.
We're just kicking it back to you.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't need a motion to tell you to do that.
Yeah.
Right? I'm just let you go right ahead and do that.
Okay.
We're not approving or denying, we're just asking for more, so. How's that sound?
That works.
Okay, next item. East Randolph.
Next item is East Randolph Community Hall update. That one's a verbal update. We have been working with the group that's calling themselves the East Valley Group. They're comprised of residents from East Randolph, also from different parts of that part of the valley. And the work that we've been doing with them is to identify problems that exist with the East Randolph Hall Community Hall. We have learned that there have been some issues that were identified before I arrived as town manager, and there was an initial plan to pay for upgrades that were required by the state marshal. Currently the building is closed because the state marshal is closed. And those repairs require ADA compliance for bathrooms, fire suppression issues, all totaling roughly about $50,000 to $60,000. Instead of doing that, we decided to engage with the community group, meet with them, identify what their strategy or what their requests are, and try to formulate a more strategic plan for going forward. in the course of the last several meetings that we've had, we determined that we needed to have a property assessment, which we've done. We received a property inspection. The inspection came back. It was pointing out many more problems than we knew existed. We had an idea that they existed, but just didn't know exactly. We have since then shared that report with contractors for just estimated amounts of what it would cost to repair the building. And the initial, non-specific, but very initial response is that it would cost roughly about $400,000 to repair the building so that it could be opened again. Not necessarily $400,000 to open it to the public, but $400,000 so that it would become a fully functional building that doesn't have structural foundation issues or interior rot or any of those other issues. So we're still working with the community group. We're going to start working with other groups. Perry has put the group into contact with many community groups, including the Preservation Trust of Vermont, to try to identify a way for this particular community group to fundraise, to find grant money, essentially be able to raise as much of that $400,000 as possible without having to spend taxpayer money or $400,000 worth of taxpayer money to rehab that hall. So the work is going to continue. We're putting together a comprehensive plan to rehab the building, and that plan will include applying for a considerable amount of money in grants. I wanted to share that with the board so that it knew where we stood with that building since it currently is closed due to the state fire marshal.
Any questions? Questions, comments from the public? Okay, thank you for the update. I apologize.
No, that's all right. If you want to put me to the end, however you want to deal with that.
No, we'll sneak in here.
Okay, thank you. My name is Jenny Carter, and I'm coming to you on a road matter. Because you all are the sort of final arbiter, I guess, on road issues according to statute. And I have an issue I wanted to bring to the attention of the select board and see what I might be able to get in terms of enlisting your help in resolving it. I live on the North Randolph Road. One of the reasons I was late is I wanted to bring you pictures like Arlo Guthrie, but then I couldn't get the pictures to print that would show you my house. Head of the road crew has, when he was out in front of my house last week, I went out to see what all they were doing, and was told that they were kind of planning how they were going to widen the road in front of my house. Because they wanted to increase the drainage. And my house sits really close to the road. It's very close to the road, so I've always been my husband and I have always been kind of protective of trying to keep as much of our front yard as we can, because our house is so close and the dust can be quite severe in the summertime, is one of the reasons that we've been we've not wanted the road to come any closer to our house. The right of way. So the main issue for us is the speed of cars and the road coming closer to our house, just because we don't like the dust and sort of losing a portion of our front yard when we have so little front yard to begin with. So I have come to you. I've tried to work. Mr. Ballion has recommended that I see if I could come to a resolution with the foreman. He even told me he was good enough to talk with me when he came out there. But he made it clear to me. He flat out said he made up his mind before he even talked to me, because he'd been told by his road crew that I haven't wanted the road to expand into my yard. So I did try talking to him again, and I've done a lot of research in terms of what the road requirements are. There are no minimum width requirements for a class 3 road, which is what I live on. There are minimum width requirements for class 2, which is a 20-foot minimum, which I think the road meets that now. Even though it's not required to. So the main thing they wanted to do was do some increased ditching. I'm fine with trying to improve the drainage on it, but I really don't think they should have to, you know, get rid of more of the grass that's in front of my yard, because that really acts as a buffer to the dust. And the closer the road travels towards my yard, the more dust there is. Now, I'm not saying that you guys don't have a right to do it. I mean, there may be some questions about it. I think it's within the right of way, as far as I can tell. But I know when I was on the Planning Commission for 10 years, when people came to us just because we had the right to do something doesn't mean there wasn't room to talk with people and to try to see if there was a way to, you know, come to a joint resolution. But as I said, the foreman made it very clear to me that he had decided before he even talked to me. And he made that clear again when I talked to him earlier today. I don't know why that is. And I can only, I will throw out one speculation, which I'm nervous about doing because I don't want to say that that is the reason. But he did tell me that earlier this year my husband had called, and he did say that he was offended by a call that my husband had made earlier this year about the road, not in front of our house, but up there after my husband had gotten stuck in the mud where it came up to the bottom of the car. I did hear my husband call, and I will say he did sound annoyed. I don't know that he sounded rude. I had called 2 days earlier about the same spot, which I think was why he might have been a little annoyed, sounded annoyed on the phone. So he did complain about my husband, thinking my husband made a rude call. I don't know if that's the reason, but I've had a hard time understanding why he's been so adamant about not willing to talk about, you know, how we might resolve the drainage issue and to see if there's a way that we can resolve it together. I was going to try to print out, Google Maps has a really good aerial or street view of my house to show you precisely what I'm talking about. I knew you guys weren't going to be able to solve this tonight, I would like to show you one thing that I did print out for you that's from the gravel roads manual. I don't know if you care about having the cover letter. But that shows a picture of what I thought would be a good compromise, which it shows on this that it's the highest rating you can have for a gravel road is a 5. And this shows a 5 rated road that I thought might have a good compromise. So it's the picture, I'm going to give you the right one. Yeah, the rating 5, just the one on the bottom looks a lot like the road by my house. So one thing, there's an old culvert in our driveway that I've lived in my house for 25 years now, and that culvert has not been in use. It was not in use when I moved in to the house. And the drainage is really funky, so I'm not saying, you know, but he has wanted to move back all the way. We have a fence. The reason I know, the road has kind of migrated over the years, getting closer to our house, and then it moves back. But this shows what I was thinking of as a compromise, is they have like the ditch, but then they have grass that comes out into the road some. So you can clean out the ditch he wants to, and I was hoping that they would maybe move the culvert a little closer to where the roadway is now, rather than just.
So your culvert? Does it go? The culvert go across?
It goes across our driveway.
So
it doesn't necessarily make it hers.
No, yeah, I don't think it is mine. I don't know.
I can see you addressing. Yeah.
Yeah, but
let me provide some information, and this may help with the rest of your discussion, okay. Or possibly in the.
And I'm trying not to be. Yeah.
So there's a municipal roads general permit. And there are grants associated with getting roads in compliance with the Municipal Roads General Permit. Two Rivers Ottauquechee is administering it on behalf of Northwest Regional Planning. There are grants available that if there's a change in drainage, that the town can get that evaluated, completely covered by this grant. I'm going to caveat it that I do this work, so I'm not advocating for more work
now.
I'm just telling you there's a program available to do it.
I'm perfectly willing to do whatever legwork you ask of me. And
I should mention that we've been talking about this issue. I suggested that communication continue with our highway superintendent, and if there was no solution there, that I would then become involved, and then we can then have that discussion on the administrative level. So that often
That's great, but the reason I came to you all tonight, and so I have, you know, some other things I can tell you, but it may or may not need to be said now, but is that the foreman said, he kind of gave me the opportunity to come talk to you all. He said, you know, because this was last week, he said, you know, he was looking to do it sooner rather than later. He said, you know, come to you. And so I would like to see if we can resolve this before they go in and take away some more of the grass in front of my house and end up widening the road. So that's why I came to you tonight. One was to see if, to whether it's you all get involved. I did think, because you had sort of deferred to the foreman, and the foreman has now told me, he really is just, I made up my mind.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I didn't defer to the foreman. What I had suggested was that you work with him to find a solution. And during that process, I also shared with you the state of Vermont's road guidelines so that you could review those. And I also suggested that if you did not find a solution with the highway superintendent, and then you and I could have a more detailed conversation about how to solve the problem.
Exactly, but you did also say that that wouldn't necessarily stop them from going ahead and doing what they were planning on doing.
It was a matter of safety, and if there was rain, and you had mentioned that you already have pooling of water in the area, and there are hydrology issues.
No, I don't have any pooling of water in the road. I said my road is about as good as it gets, man. Right, okay. In front of my house.
Right.
There is no immediate need. I probably, in the winter, in front of my house, my dirt road, like my section of dirt road, has probably the fewest potholes you will see in almost all of the Greenbelt Center. Up above me, there were problems in the spring. Up above my dirt, there were problems. So I just came to you because I wanted to see if in the end you agree with, you know, not wondering, you know, then, you know, I guess I'll just have to move that. But so, I was hoping to get you all to, one, take a look at this, because we're the final arbiters. And two, my other concern that I should put on the table, which is also why I want to postpone it at least just a little bit, is because the center line, the road expands towards me, but it doesn't expand the other side because it's sloped and then down to a stream. And I'm concerned about there being no record of where the center line is. And you did rightly tell me to talk to the lister, which I did do, and he referenced me to the town clerk's office, which I did. And I went and I looked at all the deeds, and they referenced, you know, right-of-ways of record. And I looked in the town right-of-way book, the road book, and some of it's literally not even legible because it's so old, you know. I called a surveyor today, and so I'm trying to get a surveyor out. He said, yes, center lines migrating are a problem, and especially because the right of way is so close to my house. I would really like to have it in the records where the center line is, because otherwise statute calls for, if you can't essentially reasonably determine where the center line is, the center line is in the middle of the roadway. Well, because the road's only migrating towards my house, that center line, even if it's just a, you know, it's probably moved a, you know, a couple feet since I've been in there, and now if it's gonna move a couple more, and my house right now is only 20 feet, maybe, from the right-of-way, where the edge of the right-of-way is. So I would also like to have the opportunity to get a surveyor in there to establish, you know, where the central line is. And that will be harder to do once the work's done.
Okay. Any questions?
This is right up your alley, so I'll defer to you.
Well, because it's not warned, we can't take action
right.
on it. So what we can do is advise Adolfo to follow up on it and see if we can come to a quick and amicable solution.
Sure.
And is it possible, since it isn't warned, just to ask him to ask the foreman not to do this? At least until I've gotten a survey. Is that implicit in that?
That was kind of implied with the amicable solution.
And have a chance for the surveyor to come out and do that. So I'll give, thank you. And then perhaps, if we don't, to have a form for the next meeting, we might, you all to come out. I don't know how that works, but I guess I'll continue to work with Adolfo prior to that. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next item on the agenda, the state revolving loan fund authorization.
Yes, we have discovered that the authorized signature with the Clean Water State Revolving Loan Fund and also the Drinking Water State Revolving Loan Fund still remains the old previous town manager, Melvin Adams. And so we would like the board to, if it chose to make a motion to authorize me, and then also our finance director, Michael DiCabellis, to become the new signatures for the town to be able to sign documents on behalf of the select board again.
Okay. Any questions?
I think we should let Matt have a couple of these.
Yeah, I see you show up.
Thanks. Sorry, I'm late.
It's okay. I'm going to give you a turn here.
Do you have any questions regarding the loan fund? What they do with it or anything?
So I'll make the motion. Can we finish it?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. For Adolfo and for our town finance officer to have signature authority on the state revolving fund.
Second it.
Okay, motion is made and seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 4-0-0. Loan refinance agreement from Mascoma.
This is an item that the select board had already approved at the previous meeting. This is just to authorize the select board or to inform the select board that we now have the documents to be signed, and just to wanted to make sure that it was made public that the select board would be making an official motion that had already been approved at a previous meeting. So we have the documents here for the board to sign, and it would just be to authorize the refinance of the property at 45 South Main Street.
Okay. Any questions?
I believe our clerk indicated that even though it had already been approved, that she would feel more comfortable with the motion to acknowledge that the board is going to sign the refinance agreement.
Or authorize you
to sign. Or authorize me to sign.
Well, I'll make a motion to authorize Adolfo to sign the agreement.
Second.
Okay, motion is made and seconded. Any other discussion?
This is the same one that was at the town meeting. I think that the town meeting agreed to us.
This is the selling of 45 South Main.
The.
Okay, no other discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 4-0-0. Grants. Request to apply for municipal highway grant.
The staff would like to request the select board to authorize the town to apply for a municipal highway grant and then also for a bicycle and pedestrian grant. The municipal highway grant would be to help fix some of our culverts that are failing. One in particular is North Randolph Road. We have previously applied for this grant. We were denied. We've had a trans representative come out. We made it a point to take them to the site and said, you should apply right now. So we'd like to have the board's approval to reapply for that grant. And then also, the bicycle and pedestrian grant would be to fix some sidewalk problems that exist in the village. I've asked our highway superintendent to compile a list of issues that exist. He and I will be meeting during our next one-on-one to talk about what some of these sidewalk projects are. One in particular is a sidewalk problem behind the Red Lion Inn on Pleasant Street. It currently is, it's uneven, and some of the elderly residents of the Red Lion Inn have asked that we look into repairing that sidewalk. There are also issues with sidewalks in front of the Randall House. We want to make sure that anything that is a problem that we're going to compile on the list and then work to apply for this grant and then fund some of these projects as we move forward.
Okay, any questions on the other grant? Okay, we can either handle them together or separately to authorize Mel to sign them.
I don't talk with you.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Brain cramp too. Good catch.
I move that we ask Adolfo to apply for these two grants.
Second.
Okay, motion made, seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?
Can I just ask a question, since you mentioned the North Randolph grant, where's the culvert you're talking about?
Don't know the exact location off the top of my head, but it is a field culvert down.
It's a big one about the village for the road.
Yes, that's where the problem is.
Yep.
Randolph
Road. Yeah.
That's right. Okay, motion passed 400. Old business, local emergency operations plan.
This is a plan that we have to reintroduce every year with our planning commission. We're not able to complete updating the plan for this meeting because of the issues that existed with the police department and a few other issues that are ongoing. So I would like to ask the board to table that for the next meeting.
Okay. Any preference to not do that? No? Okay, all right. Take care of next month, hopefully. All right, other business.
For other business, we have the two items that were added at the start of the meeting. One is the discussion involving RACBC for the town to potentially consider establishing guidelines for RCDC as it manages the downtown designation program, or to potentially authorize me to create a plan and then ask RCDC to return to the select board to get guidance, essentially giving them some guidance on how to continue with the managing of the downtown designation program. And the other request is the dry hydrant grant that I would like to seek authorization to apply for. Not sure which of those the board would like to talk about first.
Let's go with the dry hydrant. That'll be quicker. Proposal location?
It is I don't know the exact locations, but it is on the Brunswick School property.
Okay. So Stock Farm?
Yeah, Stock Farm, yes.
Probably out back on the big pond.
It came through us from the school and then also through Chief Collette, both were supportive of volunteers.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any questions regarding the dry hydrant grant?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I move we allow Adolfo to apply for the dry hydrant grant for Stock Farm Road School.
Okay. Brunswick School. Motion is made and seconded. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes 4-0. Okay. RACDC Downtown Administration. How do you want to handle that?
It's a fully loaded one. So I'll give the board some background.
Hey guys, can you take it outside? Thank you.
We have, naturally, when there's a change in managers, there could be some issues that exist with the way things have been operating in the past and how they're operating now. With my leadership coming in, I've asked RACBC to produce information that I felt was necessary in order for the town and the select board to understand how the downtown designation program is being run. Because that was not something that they had been asked to do in the past, they didn't have the information that I was asking, or at the very least had very limited, or in some cases, it would be very difficult for them to obtain. That has created some strain in our working relationship. It's something that we're working through. We understand that it is a relationship that we have to have. It also is one that we understand that the downtown designation program offers benefits to the town. It's not the only way to be able to benefit the town itself. There are other ways that we could benefit the town with the funds that are allocated for downtown designation, which are $20,000. But in the short term, we would like to have the board's input on how it feels that we should be working with RECDC. How it feels that the town manager and town staff should be engaging with RECDC, what limits it should place on, how it manages the downtown designation program, and whether or not it's a program that we would like to continue to have. So really the issue really lies in RECDC feels that it wants to provide what the town is asking for, but just hasn't had the opportunity to do that, and would like to seek some guidance from the select board on how to do that, how to have that relationship, how to cause the relationship that we've had in the past to morph into something that is more provable by the board and town staff. It's very vague and open-ended, but that's really what this issue is.
So what information are you asking for from them?
Data, hard facts. How have they managed the program? Whom have they met with to discuss the program? How many meetings they've had that revolve around the downtown designation program? Volunteer hours that have been spent focused on programs in the downtown designation, events, pounding the pavement, that type of thing. So I'm not asking for what I feel is out of the ordinary. It is really just basic statistics. Number of meetings, number of people they talk to, number of economic development related activities. I've received claims that events that have happened in the downtown program or in the downtown that would be attributed to the downtown designation program. I've had volunteer hours. I've asked them to give me specific hours for specific events, breakdown so that if someone from the community were to ask me, or were at some point asked the select board at any point to say, how is this program being managed? We could say, the RECDC staff have met with 50 people, have met with 100 people, have had 1,000 hours of volunteer time that have been put into these events. It's just basic statistical data.
And do you know how much has been spent on this effort to date? Mm-hmm.
Yes and no. It has been a challenge to get this information. I was given a report that I feel didn't address these questions. It was a very long, convoluted report. Since then, I've been given spurts of the information that I felt should have been in the report, but it's come in spreadsheets, it's come in different email messages. It's come in a way that I didn't feel it should be coming. If I asked for a report that I would then share with the board on how the program is being managed, I feel that it should include something like this, something that Amy gave to us in one sheet, facts, figures, specifics. Instead, we received a 16-page report that include very little of this. So those are the type of things that I'm asking from RECDC. I understand that, again, my predecessor operated in a different way. They valued different types of data and information. I'm more of a quantitative person as opposed to qualitative, and there's a difference.
I'm a little confused by the request. It seems like this is all stuff that you don't need to come to the select board for. You just work out with RECDC what you'd like them to do and set that expectation. And if it sounds like they're flexible and want to work with you, that then they just, from now going forward, know that that's the expectation and the kind of data that you'd like to see. And so they've collected and give it to you at some agreed upon intervals of time. So it seems like you have a really clear idea of the kinds of things that you want. You're a whole lot closer to it than the board is. I'm not sure why we would be. It seems like a little too much detail for us. It's really your purview.
Yeah, I, they. So RACDC has specifically requested that we bring this to the board because they feel that they want to have that connection. They want to make sure that any direction that I give to them or any direction that they feel that they are going in has the blessing of the select board. They want to make sure that what I'm sharing with them is that if we're working together, then it is RACDC and the town working together as opposed to RACDC, how they feel they may be just floating in the wind and not know exactly what to do, so they feel that they're doing what they need to do. So I brought it to the board because they asked essentially to have this discussion to see if the board wanted to have that input or authorize me just to continue to do my work and work with them there, which I certainly continue to do. I wanted to make sure I gave them that courtesy of bringing it to the board.
I believe Trini had some comments on that as well.
Yes. Trini did suggest that we have, at the very least, some members consider to not necessarily establish a committee, but at the very least commit to working with RACDC to engage more with them to develop a scope of work and how to establish some guidelines for RACDC on how to manage the program. Seems like it would be more of a direct involvement with the board and RACDC to give them that guidance.
So is there a preference to have us participate or continue to have Adolfo for the time being, I guess? Mm-hmm.
So I've had some conversations with some of the board members of RACDC. And to understand better what they've been doing, I've asked for similar information that Adolfo's asked for. And I had specifically had said, you know, it would be nice to see a spreadsheet that shows, you know, what positive benefits, you know, that you guys have contributed to the community or to individuals or grants or, you know, the downtown designation program is supposed to be something that helps people, you know, be able to take tax credits and things like this. So I've asked for that kind of information for my own personal needs to see just what they're doing. And at the present time, I believe that's something that I'm going to get. And I think it's very similar to what Adolfo has asked for. I just simply asked for it in a spreadsheet because I wanted to see what dollar values, you know, if we're spending $20,000, I'd like to see, you know, what we're getting for our $20,000. Are we getting back $100,000 annually, or are we getting back $50,000, or, you know, did we get anything? I don't know. So for me to better understand it, I specifically asked these board members to bring the topic up and say, look, you know, in order to show everybody in the community what's going on here, this is what, you know, would be beneficial to see. So that's what I've done.
I believe the conversation came up a year or so ago where we started looking into grants, and that this was a grant to them to administer the downtown designation. So at the time, the discussion was to find out what we were getting for that.
So to me, I think, you know, personally, I'd rather support Adolfo and his movement forward trying to collect the data and say, hey, select board stands up. And said, you know, we support Adolfo trying to get this, and we'd like to see the data as well. You know, once he assembles it, I mean, getting somebody else involved at this point, I'm not sure buys anything
that's,
if two people are pressuring.
That's what I think would work the best. You know, I've, like I said, thrown out some ideas. This is what might be helpful for us to see. So if they can pass that along to Adolfo, that would be great.
So the board's preference is to continue with Adolfo being point, and we'll get involved once more.
Yeah, I think there's a time frame that goes out in that, you know, 2-3 months or whatever it is, and if it doesn't change, then we should revisit and try to decide how we can help.
Sounds good to me.
Okay. Is that all right with you, Aaron? Okay. So we'll continue as is for now.
Okay.
And revisit once we get more information, or we need to get involved on a more wider discussion basis. Yeah. Okay. Anything else in other business?
No.
Okay. Manager's report?
I have one one item that's not on the agenda, and the one item is that we have been working on helping the chamber with the 4th of July parade. Actually, most of you have not yet met Shannon Hance. She's an administrative assistant who's taking minutes, sitting right over there. And Shannon has been helping us on a number of things, but the most recent is to obtain a flyover from the National Guard for the 4th of July parade. It looks like it may be possible to have one, which would be great, but the National Guard has asked if the select board or if the town would be okay with having a National Guard recruiting station. I don't know what type of capacity that would be, whether it would be like their standard rock wall that they usually bring and have three National Guard members out. My thought is, when the town accepts federal money, we are already participating in part of that. We have one of our command officers in the police department who's a member of the National Guard. I thought it would be perfectly fine, but we wanted to make sure that the board reviewed the stipulation and got back to the National Guard with approval. If the board approves and or doesn't think it's a problem, then we can continue with the process.
Well, I support that. There's a number of National Guard members in the community.
Agreed.
Thanks. We don't know if we are going to get the flyover, but most people are very pleased about it. We are also hearing that some of the horses may be spooked by it, so we don't know. Everyone's, for the most part, happy.
Yeah, I think you could alleviate some of that if you contacted people who said they're going to have animals in their portion, folded, their portion of the parade, that maybe they could mitigate any issues.
Yeah.
And Steak Riding Club probably would be a contact for that, right?
But yeah, there's also oxen. And
yeah, there's the oxen, yeah, so yeah, certainly would be.
We'll work on that.
Yeah.
Okay, anything else?
Nope.
All right, I will entertain a motion to enter executive session pursuant to VSA 313-1B. Motion made and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
Carried.
I went over it quickly, and I didn't know how you gentlemen do things. It's my first select board meeting. And not only that, we have not had... since I've been in Randolph for 7 years, a budget committee presentation to the select board formally. So I am looking to get information as well as give it at this point. I know all you folks. I know Adolfo Perry was on the budget committee for a little while when I was there. We've been on the rec committee together. Matt, we know each other.
Yeah.
Mike is the select board representative to the budget committee, so he, has access to our meetings, and he's there every month as well. So, you guys all know that there's a sharing of information that goes on continually throughout our process. In discussion, I'm not the chairman of the committee. Michael Penrod is. I know he feels very strongly that we have channels of communication that currently exist, and that is the role of the budget committee to bring any issues to the select board, if and when we find issues, at the time we find issues. If we are doing our due diligence as we do every month, and we meet and we question line items in the budget, we compare actual expenses to budget items on a monthly basis when those financials are provided by Mike DiCavellis. And the combination of Adolfo and Michael answer all our questions at the meeting. Anything that needs research is put in the minutes and followed up on the following monthly meeting. So there's quite a lengthy process of analyzing the budget line item by line item. As I said, we've never done a formal presentation to the select board. I feel it is our job and our duty to bring any questionable items where we do not receive adequate explanation to the select board. And In my time on the budget committee, which is now going on about 5 or 6 years, there's been one item that we've brought actively to the select board, and that was to make sure that they were aware that when Stagecoach, instead of just being an appropriation item, was also added into the line item budget, that was something we brought forward to make sure that they were aware of. In my tenure, there has never been a line item that we did not receive a satisfactory explanation on from either the town manager at the time or from the finance director. So I'm here to report that we are doing our job. The budget committee in times in the past had met sort of quarterly and then more frequently towards the close of the budget process and then when financials are closed for the year end. In my tenure, we've changed that to a monthly meeting, which occasionally we may cancel one if there are no substantial changes to the finances, to the reports as provided by Mike DeCavalis. Mike Penrod is not a permanent resident of Randolph, so we actually canceled our May meeting because there were no new developments. But aside from that, one-off, we meet consistently every month and more frequently as needed. So I'm here to report that we are at your beck and call if there's anything you would like us to do as far as further follow-up. Mike, you know probably better than anybody what we go through on a monthly basis at our meetings, the level to which we question items and dig in, everything from when the heating bill jumps, or if we spend more money on plows and chains because of icy conditions in a winter, if the pool suddenly has a big jump in the amount of money it's spending on water. These are items we see, and we jump on, and we ask for explanations, and we receive those explanations. So as far as a formal report, that's what I have for you tonight. Anything you have for me as a takeaway, I will certainly take that on.
I think we just got our quarterly report, right?
Exactly. Is this sort of what you folks are looking for? If it's anything different at all, please let me know, and we can modify. There's a paragraph. When the budget committee was brought into existence back 20 years ago, there was no email. I probably didn't have Excel. The exchange of information was not as smooth as it is now, as easy as it is now. And our marching orders really is like two paragraphs in an old town meeting report that we found. So as far as this specific item is going, I would appreciate any direction that you have other than what I've been able to provide for you tonight.
I would recommend that so that you can clear up any miscommunications to consider changing your charter. That could be voted on. And so then I think as the charter is written, the committee's not in compliance with it, which understandably technology changes. And so maybe the charter needs to change with times. And so instead of just changing it, then proposing it gets on next annual meeting's ballot or for discussion. Since you're voted in at the town meeting, that it gets changed there, and I think that would be an appropriate course of action.
So are you suggesting that we sort of look at the way we're doing business and kind of streamline the whole, just take a fresh look at the charter and rewrite it, or is there something specific as far as how we're going to report that you would like to?
Well, I think it says you're supposed to show up here quarterly, right, or something
yes.
like that.
Yeah, I mean,
so
I would
consider changing that to providing a written report, on a quarterly basis and monthly if there are, I don't want to use the word significant because that's a subjective term, but significant issues, and you would maybe define how those issues would be considered significant.
Okay. And if you'd like to have further discussion as far as, I don't know, itemizing the line items that we've researched, or if you would like just to report sort of like an auditor's report at the end of a financial statement saying, we've reviewed everything and to our knowledge everything is according to, explained sufficiently by the finance director and or town manager.
Yeah, for me it would be, a general statement saying everything's good, but then as the 20,000 gallons to fill the pool has changed 4 line items in 2 years. Things like that, I think, would be important to us as we're reviewing the board later, because putting 20,000 gallons into the pool, shifting from the rec to the building to this to that, it's kind of important to see. And then the whole board gets the explanations for why something changes in the next budget cycle.
See, and here's where I could use some guidance as well, because, you know, we have a select board member on the budget committee who could be there to hear this stuff firsthand. Michael DeCavellis is, as you know, the guy that has line and verse on every item. He signs all the purchase orders, and he's the one that usually does the research into any one of these line items. He has discussions with Adolfo, with Heidi, about the water, and this discussion has gone from, you know, why is it so expensive, to, okay, the water is actually charged by the sewer based on an estimate of what goes in, because they figure what goes into the pool comes out into the sewers, and that's not the case. Quite a bit of pool water evaporates, as we know, right? Some of it gets splashed out and absorbed into the ground. So what's going into the pool is not going into the sewer. So that line of reasoning is being pursued. Is there a credit to get back from the sewer and water if we can more accurately measure the amount of water that's actually going into the sewer system and not literally evaporating into thin air? Right? So I don't know at what level of detail the select board would like to know about that. Like, we see a large expense on pool water that is explained, but we're research. You know what I'm saying? Like, what is it I can give you guys? Is what I'm.
Well, I'm thinking just significant items. You know, just the general statement that you said that, you know, you're doing your job and you've looked over the budget and everything appears to be the way it was planned.
Yeah.
Except for this item. Or, you know, and if there was none of those, then you would just leave the original statement.
Yeah. I typically think you could do that on a percentage base, right? If any category change was
difficult, and that is sometimes you get a $100 line item that changes by 10,000% because
it's both.
Yeah.
It's percent. I think we said $2,000 or 10%, whichever is less. But that does not preclude us from asking any question whatsoever. I mean, I've questioned, you know, postage that went from, you know, had a spike of a few hundred bucks, just so I would understand the process and why we're spending hundreds of dollars on postage, like what is being mailed, you know? So we are free to question any line item, and we probably have hit them all over the last 5 years, big or small. Often, even when there isn't a question, we'll ask procedural questions like, you know, the Smith Barney, this is posted at the end of the year, and what's the process? And, you know, other things like the property tax rebate from the state, you know, it's an unknown. So, you know, Michael's spent some time explaining like how that process works, even though it's not really in the purview of the budget committee per se. But we really go through it with a fine-tooth comb, pretty much.
Is the current format and setup working well? I know that there are occasional participation problems, and I'm actually questioning the legality of a non-permanent resident being on the committee, but not that Mike's not doing a good job, but I just want to know if the current setup is working. 3 people, monthly, quarterly, whatever, and the level of participation, you know, because...
Well, since you asked a sort of a direct question, I'll give you a direct answer. I can't remember last time I saw CJ. Is it working? Michael Perlman and I, we're at the meetings all the time. We communicate. We ask our issues. Now, one thing we do is to overcome some of the proximity issues. Michael DeCavellis will send out electronic version of the financials. We are allowed to ask questions electronically, and those go to the group. He's not allowed to respond to them electronically. That has to be in the meeting. So we do share information prior to the meeting. We tried a couple of times to have someone phone into the meeting. It really doesn't work. It's the kind of meeting that just feels like it needs to be face-to-face. And aside from Michael Penrod missing a couple meetings in the summertime, we've kind of scheduled around it. You know, we do have flexibility. I have flexibility because I work from home. A little less flexibility when middle school baseball is in season, as you've witnessed tonight. But we start off every session after annual meeting day asking if anybody needs to make a change to the meeting time so we can make it. So it works for me. It works pretty well for Michael Penrod. And I don't know what CJ's issues are. I sent her emails asking her if the time commitment is too much for her, if she's spread too thin, and she has not replied that it is. She continues to say that she thinks she can make meetings and then it just doesn't happen. So, and it's been more than a couple now. I think it's been quite a few. I don't know if it's been like five or six in a row, but at least over the last year, I think she probably missed like half of them, if not more.
Okay.
Michael Penrod, I don't think we can't, but as I mentioned, we canceled the May meeting. It was supposed to happen earlier in the week. But other than canceling that meeting, Michael hasn't missed one.
All right. Any questions or comments?
I think your idea of maybe changing the charters may be a good idea because, you know, that was done in, did you say, 97?
Yeah.
Right. A lot of things have changed since then, you know, and so my take on it is that you're getting a lot of information now that simply can be emailed to you, that similar to what I do in the Planning Commission, you know, we get a lot of stuff early, we can look stuff over, we can just, you know, I can focus on what I think might be something that needs to be addressed. Probably the same thing's happened to the Budget Committee, it's just maybe the charter doesn't quite fit what the Budget Committee really could be doing or how it should be done. So I think that's a perfectly appropriate place to go to work and to see if that gets changed. And, you know, maybe we need nothing more than an email quarterly that just says, hey, this is what's going on, or a report to Adolfo that just, yep, this is what happened, you know, we saw this little spike in this and we looked at it and we asked a question and, you know, we got the answer. So I think a lot of things that were going on, you know, 30 years ago are totally different today when it comes to information sharing and meetings and productivity. So that's my take on it. So maybe it's just time to rewrite that.
Would the board be open to considering, unless there are any major significant issues that happen between now and town meeting, to forego the quarterly briefings, or would it still like at least one more briefing between now and the end of the year before, you know, if the board wishes, I could work with the Budget Committee to put a question on the ballot for next town meeting. That changes the format,
right? Yeah. I'm fine with, you know, if you see something that spikes out of control, obviously we all want to know about that. So in my mind, I could say you could forego the quarterly meeting process if that's something we can do, and just understand that they're going to communicate when they need to.
Well, I mean, it's in the charter.
Yeah.
I mean, it probably has to, like, I don't think we can say you don't have to do it. Having said that, no one can force you to show up.
Right. But it even doesn't have to be that they have to be present.
I don't.
Could it be as simple as a report to Adolfo that shares with us and we get in a packet quarterly?
Well, why don't we ask the Budget Committee to consider a few methods of delivery and then we can try them out through the end of the year. So that way when they do the ballot question in January, that they're well informed and get some feedback, and then,
sure,
they can go from there.
That sounds great.
Is there anything in the statute that says they have to show up?
It says a quarterly formal presentation.
Quarterly formal presentation.
It specifically says,
okay.
Yeah.
It does not define what that means.
No.
I'm sure it doesn't.
So I can come and talk next time.
It's up to you. We'll make you rent one.
I actually have one from my previous life.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, you know, what's the definition of a formal, whatever you want to call it?
Yeah,
okay.
It's for you guys. So I, and I'm only saying guys because there are no ladies
present tonight.
So really big, right? So for you folks, you know, we ideally would have a representative from your committee at the Budget Committee meeting every month, so you hear firsthand what's going on.
So any of these, you know, side discussions that may be too time-consuming to address here, at least you've got, you know, an ear to the ground, and you can see any problems before they happen while we're in sort of the discovery stage with this stuff. Any issues like that, they're going in our minutes, just so we don't lose track of them. You know, things to be followed up on. We could go anywhere from, you know, a detailed list of all the items we questioned in the last 3 months for the quarterly report, or we can say, we've continued the process of which we've made you aware, and there are no issues to raise at this point. I can do that formally here once every.
I don't think every question, because
so
I've participated in those meetings. I would say the ones that don't receive a sufficient.
We fill our hour, whether we need to or not.
I would think you would just report on the ones that didn't receive a sufficient answer to.
Right.
Okay.
And with some sort of significance.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, if it goes from 100 to 200 and you ask,
and
you
not
get an answer
it.
That says, yeah, this happened, then we probably don't need to know about that.
Right.
But if it goes from 10,000 to 25,000 and you get a good answer, then we should probably still hear about that one.
Okay.
Something that seems
to be. The electricity bill went down, and it's because of the LED lights that were put up in town.
Yeah.
The old incandescent ones were taken down. So why wasn't the budget reduced? Like, who knows? But,
well, now you know, because now you can reduce the budget, because now you've
right.
got that data, right?
Right. Right, so I mean, it's the level we look into things.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a lot of line items, that's for sure.
1,128 line items.
What is it now? How much?
Like 1,100.
Yeah, I thought it was over 1,000.
There's a lot of gaps and titles in there,
that's significant.
Well, it's not a continuous report. It's set up so it's by page.
It's
and so it prints by page into Excel. So there's, in some areas, there's 30 lines in between the next line item, even though it's a continuous item.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions, comments?
Great. Thanks for coming.
Thanks, Rick.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Rick.
Again, sorry I'm late.
Thank you.
No problem.
Okay.
All righty.
Okay, now I'll entertain a motion to enter executive session.
All right. So moved.
With the Dolphin?
With the doubtful present.
With the doubtful present. So
moved.
Second.
All those favors signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.